But with that, let's move to our featured speaker. Our featured speaker tonight is a fellowship-trained cardiologist. He is president and CEO of Wisconsin Cardiology Associates. He is past president and current trustee of the Wisconsin chapter of the American College of Cardiology. He's a member of the American College of Cardiology's National Nutrition and Lifestyle Work Group, whose membership includes nationally known physicians such as Dr. Dean Ornish, Dr. Caldwell Esselstyn, and Dr. Neil Bernard. He's an advocate for the use of plant-based nutrition to help improve heart health, general health, and quality of life, and has seen the benefits of plant-based nutrition in both his personal life and that of his patients. We're fortunate to have him here in Milwaukee as our PBNL medical director and as a cardiologist. I'm happy to welcome our featured speaker tonight, Dr. Joshua Liberman. Dr. Liberman?
Hey, Terry, thank you. Thanks for the introduction, as always, very kind. Thanks to everybody for being here. A nice big crowd for this night, so thank you very much. Hopefully, everybody's enjoying a little bit of the cooler weather. We had some real hot days there this summer, and it's nice to see kind of the colors in the trees changing and the heat relenting a little bit. So I guess I give a little blurb about some recent study that came out or talk about patient results from my clinic. But because I'm the featured speaker tonight, I figured I would just go right into the talk, actually, I think. If that's okay. So do I have, it looks like I have power to share. And let's do desktop sharing that.
It's coming up.
Is it up?
It's up.
All right, sorry, can you see that?
Yes.
Wonderful. Okay, so let me clear my throat here for a sec. All right, so I figured, we get a lot of talks on these Thursday nights about nutrition. Obviously, it makes sense. We're called the Plant-Based Nutrition Organization Wisconsin. But I figured we could maybe go parallel to that and not focus exclusively on nutrition, but talk about some other habits as well as nutrition, of course, that are really good for healthy aging. And with that, I'm going to skip through that. I want to focus on, so the American Heart Association has come up with this, this new kind of way of looking at health. And up until, I think about 2020-ish, they had seven metrics, seven kind of domains of health, and they called it Life's Simple Seven. And it was basically all eight of these except the sleep. But it was healthy nutrition, smoking cessation, exercise, having a healthy weight, that's BMI, body mass index, having control of sugars, not having blood pressure, and not having cholesterol issues. So about a couple of years ago, they added in sleep and they changed the terminology to life's essential eight. But we know that if you have good habits in each of these domains, and if you have good numbers and good control of everything in these eight domains, we have really, really good evidence that that leads to longevity and to excellent health. Now, I'm not going to talk about all of these tonight, but I did want to highlight a couple of them. So let's start, if that's okay, with exercise. So exercise, I guess we can hold that up. We get this a lot. At least I can hear some chuckling on there. I know most people have been muted. So so the problem with exercise is that not enough of us do it and not enough of us do enough. In the recent American Heart Association statistical analysis and breakdown, They reported that less than a third of people over the age of 60 certainly had ideal levels of physical activity. That is pretty pitiful. Because we know that there are tons of health benefits of exercise. There's a lower risk of dying if you're exercising. I mean, of course, we all die ultimately. But dying prematurely is something that we can do things to avoid. And there's a lower risk of dying prematurely, certainly when you are exercising regularly. There's a lower risk of dying from cardiovascular causes. Of course, we can improve blood pressure. We can improve insulin sensitivity and lower blood sugars. We can improve quality of sleep. We can reduce anxiety and depression. There's a lot of good evidence about that. There's reduced risk of injuries from falls, and our brains can work better with regular exercise. There's also decreased risks of cancer. All these different cancers have been shown to be lower in terms of their incidence in people who are exercising regularly. And physical inactivity is the number two most powerful risk factor for stroke. Number one being high blood pressure. And of course, physical activity and blood pressure are correlated. They're related to each other. But being a couch potato is the second most powerful risk factor for stroke. There was a study that came out now a number of years ago that said that just replacing 30 minutes of sitting with light activity, right? We're not talking that you have to start training for a marathon or doing some crazy workouts or anything like that, right? This is just light activity was associated with a 17% lower risk of early death. That's a huge number. And if you did moderate or even vigorous exercise, that doubled the benefit to a 35% lower risk. When compared to the least active individuals, the most active people have a 30 to 40% lower risk of developing heart disease, hardening of the arteries. And patients with heart disease, if you already have heart disease, have a 27% lower chance of dying from that heart disease if you are exercising when compared to the least active people. And so in 2018, there was an update to the physical activity guidelines. These are actually put out by the federal government. They do it every 10 years. So the one before that was in 2008. And they defined sufficient physical activity as 150 minutes per week of moderate intensity aerobic activity. So what's moderate intensity? Really, it could be just a brisk walk. It doesn't have to be anything crazy. They do also recommend 2 days per week of muscle strengthening activity. That could be weightlifting, that could be push-ups, that could be isometric exercises like planks or wall sits or things like that. It could be a lot of different things. And so this is what I tell my patients. We know that maintaining or improving fitness is clearly definitively associated with a lower risk of premature death. And it turns out that the amount of exercise you do makes a much larger difference than the intensity of exercise, right? So people ask me all the time, how hard do I need to go, right? And I just say, yes. And they say, huh? And I say, it does not matter how hard. I just need you to do it. I just need you to do it. You need you to do it. It's the duration that is more important than the intensity. The goal, as I said, is 30 minutes, right? That's 150 minutes a week, 5 days a week, that is. 30 minutes of moderate intensity exercise most days of the week, 5 to 7 days a week. That would be the goal. Somebody go chase that dog, get some exercise. Even walking briskly for just 10 to 15 minutes a day is associated with a significant risk a significantly lower risk of developing heart disease or diabetes. And there's tons of studies that show that even down to 5 to 10 minutes a day is beneficial. And it turns out that going from zero activity to mild to moderate activity gives you the most benefit, much more than being an average exerciser and going to vigorous, right? Now, that doesn't mean that you don't have to bother going from moderate intensity to vigorous intensity. You just don't have to. There is a point of diminishing return. The sweet spot is probably within in the range of 30 minutes to 60 minutes. 30 to 60 minutes is probably the ideal amount. So if you're out there exercising for 2 hours, great. Have fun. Hope you're enjoying it. But I don't want you to think that you need to be doing that to get the benefit, right? And in fact, exercising for 2 hours does not give you twice the benefit of exercising for 1 hour, right? But the key is whatever, especially if you're not doing anything, to start doing something, because there's a huge amount of benefit from going from zero to even just mild intensity, short duration exercise. Right? So 3 times a week, just running around your living room can help you. All right. That's enough about exercise for now. Let's talk about sleep. This is something that we don't spend a lot of time talking about, but I have a lot of patients coming into my office with difficulty sleeping. Part of that is that we're just very overprogrammed and we have so many things that we need to be doing. Part of it is anxiety, the amounts of anxiety in this world right now. I mean, the world outside is anxiety inducing, but the levels, not just in our kids, which, you know, there's a lot of news reports about that, but the levels of anxiety are crazy high in our world right now. And I think that both of those things, both the fact that we are working harder than ever to stay afloat, as well as the anxiety that that causes, but also just the rest of the world, I think those two facts are contributing to issues with sleep amongst our population. So the two most common sleep issues are sleep apnea, which is not anxiety related or overworking related, but it is a sleep disorder, and insomnia. Those are the two most frequently encountered sleep disorders. I try to screen all of my new patients, every new patient that walks in into my office, I try to screen them for sleep apnea. So what is sleep apnea? You may have a loved one or a relative with this or a coworker, but sleep apnea is categorized basically by complete and incomplete blocking or occlusion of airways during sleep, right? So we all go into, we all fall asleep into a light sleep, and then we drop down into a deep sleep. And for many of us out there, when we drop into that deep sleep, our airway collapses for one of a number of reasons. The throat closes down basically, and there's no air getting in or out, or there's less air getting in or out. And so you stop breathing, or at least you dramatically slow down your breathing. And that takes a toll on the body, the heart, the lungs, everything. If it happens frequently throughout the night, it can result in reduced oxygen levels in your bloodstream. It can, and certainly it reduces it. It leads to reduced quality of sleep, where you're not getting that sustained REM sleep that is rejuvenating and restorative for us, and that we need to be functional. That's sleep apnea. That is a medical condition. Insomnia really can be a medical condition also, or it could be behavioral. So it's really characterized by 3 symptoms that we try to ask about. Is it difficulty initiating sleep, right? So falling asleep, can you fall asleep okay? Can you stay asleep, right? Or do you wake up frequently? And of course, if you have trouble falling asleep and you're waking up frequently, that's a bad combination, because that means every time you wake up, it takes you forever to sleep again. And then, of course, there's early morning awakening, where you're waking up super early and then you're done. You can't fall asleep again. So the American Academy of Sleep Medicine and the Sleep Research Society recommend that adults obtain, really, it's 7 to 8 hours of sleep per night to promote optimal health. I'll go through some evidence with you here, but the sweet spot here is 7 to 8 hours a night. So you can do the math and see what you're doing now. Just like I said, the sweet spot for exercise is 30 minutes to an hour. The sweet spot for sleep is 7 to 8 hours of sleep per night. And actually, I'll spoil the rest of my slides here for a bit. But it turns out that sleeping less than 7 hours consistently is bad for your health. but also sleeping more than 8 hours consistently is a sign of poor health or is a poor prognostic sign too, right? So if you're sleeping 10 hours a day, that's not necessarily a healthy thing. And it's pretty common. The proportion of people out there reporting insufficient sleep as recently as 2020 was about 33%. One in three adults were reporting insufficient sleep. Curiously, older adults over the age of 65 have the lowest prevalence of insufficient sleep, meaning older adults over the age of 65 have less problems with getting sleep. Their sleep is usually reasonable and sufficient. So maybe, again, that's a function of many people over the age of 65 are retired, and so they don't have to keep crazy schedules to support their families and whatnot, which obviously the stress of that can interrupt sleep. Unfortunately, just like many things in our country, there are huge discrepancies based on race in terms of health outcomes and health quality. This is really it's a travesty. It's a shame. We should all be ashamed of the major differences in health outcomes based on ethnicity and race. Non-Hispanic, that's that NH, non-Hispanic Black adults had the highest percentage of poor sleep duration, right? They had the highest percentage of people under 6-7 hours of sleep a night. 43% in this one study, 43% of non-Hispanic Black adults got insufficient sleep. I mean, that's awful. We got to do something about this. Of course, like a lot of other health outcomes, non-Hispanic white adults had the least issues with sleep duration. As I said, skip through that. Both short sleep and long sleep are associated with greater risk of all-cause mortality. That's dying from any cause. But over the age of 65, sleep duration was no longer significantly associated with mortality. Again, not clear why this is. Not clear why sleep duration doesn't seem to be an issue once you get past 65 years old. But certainly under the age of 65, we should be aiming for 7 to 8 hours of sleep a night. And compared to that 7 to 8 hours, every 1 hour reduction in sleep is associated with a 6% increased risk of total cardiovascular disease, 7% increased risk of coronary heart disease, that's blockages, and a 5% increased risk of stroke. And those were all statistically significant numbers. And now those don't seem very big, but again, sleep is just one aspect of our health, right? And if our blood pressure is not good or if our cholesterol is good, you can very easily see how quickly our risk for bad things happening starts to skyrocket. In the UK Biobank study, which I've talked about in the past, it's about 1 million people who have contributed to research in the United Kingdom by giving blood samples and answering really extensive questionnaires and even having their DNA checked and all sorts of different things, right, for the last really 10 years. They looked at different aspects of sleep, you know. Do you have a normal sleep cycle, right? Are you working third shift, or are you waking up in the morning or in the evening? What is your sleep duration? Do you have insomnia rated as never or rarely or sometimes? Are you a snorer? Do you have excessive daytime sleepiness? Basically, the bottom line is that every 1 point increase, increased scores are unhealthy, right? So a high score means that you're snoring and you have insomnia and your sleep duration is too short. So a 1 point increase in the healthy sleep score was associated with low sleep scores in this study were associated with poor outcomes. Higher sleep scores in this metric were associated with better outcomes. and a better sleep score was associated with a 15% reduced incidence of heart failure. Sorry, I mixed up my metrics. People with non-restful sleep, 16% higher risk of cardiovascular disease. Difficulty initiating sleep, 22%. Difficulty maintaining sleep. So these are the kind of the aspects of insomnia that we talked about earlier. And really any insomnia complaint was associated with a 13% higher risk of bad things. So you can understand that sleep plays a huge role in our health. And this is certainly the reason that the American Heart Association added it in to our, you know, the healthy kind of metric scores. So it'd be, so before I get to this, it'd be really cruel for me to tell you that sleep is a big deal if you're having difficulty sleep and then just leave it at that, right? There's nothing more frustrating for people who have insomnia because they know that they're not getting sleep. They know they feel terrible, and telling them that they need to sleep is like the worst thing you could do, right? Just saying, oh, well, Mr. Jones, you just need to sleep more. Okay. Yeah, right. Easier said than done. Thanks, doc. Thanks, but no thanks. So with that in mind, the answer is not always take a pill, right? There are some over-the-counter things certainly people can try. Melatonin works for some people, not for everybody. L-tryptophan works for some people, not everybody. Certainly exercise, increasing exercise can improve sleep quality. We saw that earlier. But then there's also, well, of course, there's prescription medications. People, I'm sure, are familiar with something like Ambien, which, you know, unfortunately can be habit forming and people feel like they can be dependent on it. Maybe not the greatest. There are some other medicines out there you can talk to your doctors about that maybe don't have the same shtick that Ambien gets. But what I've found in my patients can really work is working on sleep hygiene. So what does that mean? Well, making sure your environment is conducive to sleep. So some of the things I recommend for my patients are not using screens or technology or TVs for at least an hour before you want to go to sleep. So if you're planning to go to sleep at, say, 10:30, that means turning off technology at 9:30 and doing something more contemplative or meditative, like reading a book or doing a crossword puzzle or something along those lines. And when I say reading a book, I don't mean reading on a tablet or an e-reader. I mean an actual, honest to God, you know, book that's bound and made out of paper. Same thing with crossword puzzles, like an actual newspaper crossword puzzle or one of those books with 100 crossword puzzles in it, but no screens, no bright lights. Even if the lights are dim, there's what's called blue light emanating from those screens. And the blue light penetrates to the back of your brain, and the back of your brain sees that it's getting light and says, oh, it must be daytime out there. We should not start to try to fall asleep. So you want to try to enhance the hormones of sleepiness as you get later in the day. And you don't want to defeat that by having screens. The other thing we tell patients is that you shouldn't actually read or do anything in bed other than sleep, right? Sleep, the bed should be for sleep. And so if you are having trouble sleeping, get out of the bed. What I tell my patients is don't spend more than 20 minutes in your bed tossing and turning. If you can't fall asleep in 20 minutes, you got to get out and you got to do something else. Read a book, do a crossword puzzle, a Sudoku, search word, anything like that. Read a magazine, something with dim light, not really bright light, but dim light and something analog, not technology-based. You do that for about 20 minutes and then you try to get back into bed. And you just cycle that back and forth all night long, if you have to, until you retrain your brain that the only thing that happens in bed is sleep. So that's what we call sleep hygiene, trying to help have your environment help you fall asleep. When that doesn't work, we move to what's called CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy. And that's what this slide is for. So there's a couple websites out there that you can try. The top one, Sleepio. It happens to be effective. Unfortunately, it's not available to the public. It's a benefit provided by many large companies. So your employer would support this benefit. And so when you go to the website, it actually asks you who your employer is to see if you know one of the 100 or 150 employers that use that pay for this or cover this if it would be covered. And if that's the case, then it's totally free. CBT4insomnia.com is a different thing that's available to the public. There is a cost to it, but they tout that they improve sleep in 80%, almost 80% of insomnia patients, and certainly reduces or eliminates the need for sleeping pill use in 90% of patients. Those would be big numbers. That's a 5-week program. And then that last one there is Shut Eye. Funny name, Shut Eye. That is also a cognitive behavioral therapy based program that you can access. There's a couple ways you can get into that program. Again, this is all private pay kind of stuff, but they can be extremely effective at basically retraining your brain to be able to relinquish control, release, and let you fall asleep. Okay. And any plant-based nutrition organization of Wisconsin talk really does need to include nutrition, I would say. You guys have all, many of you, I'm sure, have heard this from me before. But if anybody is on any one of these talks, you know what the general parameters are of what we advocate and what we recommend and the benefits of those things. But I guess I do want to highlight how big a problem it is out there that adults over the age of 60, under 1% of adults over the age of 60 achieved ideal levels for this metric that this research group called the Healthy Diet Score. And out of all the different, out of all those like eight, life's essential eight, AHA, American Heart Association metrics, nutrition, people did the worst with nutrition over the age of 60. What does that mean? The numbers and percentages of people exercising, people who quit smoking, people who had a healthy body weight, people who had their blood pressure controlled, all those other things had much higher percentages than people who were achieving healthy diets, right? So it's just, as much as we talk about this, it still is a big issue in the population of this country. As Terry says at the beginning of every meeting, we know that improvements in dietary intake have been conclusively linked to decreases in a lot of bad things. Some of them are listed up here and on that video that really wasn't working. We were hearing even more about sleep and sexual function and acne, skin tone, and all that jazz. This is not a new concept. You guys, every plant-based nutrition talk, I feel like, has one of these kinds of quotes in it. But for hundreds or thousands of years, we've known that the fuel we put into our bodies determines how our bodies will run, which really should not be that surprising, frankly. Right? The fuel you put into your car determines how it's going to run. If you are lucky enough in this world to be able to have a super luxury car, like a Ferrari or a Bentley or something along those lines, I'm pretty confident that they tell you at the dealership, I don't even know if you buy those things at a dealership, but in any case, I'm pretty confident that they tell you when you buy it that you can't put in the cheap fuel, right? That you have to put in the high grade, high octane gasoline, the most expensive gasoline, right? You need to put quality fuel to make an engine like that run well. Well, we need to put quality fuel into our bodies to make our engines run well. So in observational studies, clinical trials, randomized controlled trials, all sorts of different ways of getting evidence, we know that plant-based diets have significantly lower cholesterol, lower rates of death from heart disease, and so many other things. Like curing diabetes, improving blood pressure, preventing and reversing early prostate cancer, reducing risk of colon and breast cancer, and all these different things. We don't need to go into all of those. And why? I think some people may have seen this recently. I gave a talk a couple weeks ago that had some of these same slides. I really do think it's a mixture of what plants have and what they don't have, right? plants have plant-based proteins with slightly different amino acids than some animal than animal-based proteins. Plants, of course, have, well, I shouldn't say of course, plants have monounsaturated fats and polyunsaturated fats, and of course plants have tons of fiber. What they don't have is cholesterol. They don't have saturated fat for the most part. Coconut oil is a saturated fat, and that's of course a plant, but they don't have heme iron, which is what why we call red meat red meat. They don't have trimethylamine oxide, TMAO. They don't have advanced glycation end products, AGs. They don't have heterocyclic amines. They don't have carnitine. All those things sound bad, and they are bad. Right? So the bad stuff, red meat, bad. Increases risk for atherosclerosis, diabetes, stroke, cancer. All those cancers have been shown to have strong links to red meat. And for each additional 3 ounces of red meat consumed daily, risk of death from heart disease was 16% higher, and risk of death from cancer is 10% higher. Those are not good numbers. And if you substituted out a serving of red meat with a serving of nuts or even low-fat dairy or whole grains, in this study at least, it was associated with a 20 to 30% lower risk of diabetes. So almost anything, even if you're not plant-based, anything is going to be better than red meat. Processed meat, well, I should say that. Processed meat is the worst. 20 to 25% increased risk of stroke the more processed meat you ate. And I think maybe some of you know this because it's a, you know, people often present it in these kinds of talks, but the World Health Organization has classified processed meats like bacon as a group one carcinogen, right? Which is the same class as tobacco or asbestos. And you wouldn't eat those for breakfast, I'm sure. Higher intake of processed meat, as I said, increased risk of stroke. Sorry, that's a duplicative side. Saturated fat, right. So switching from saturated fat to unsaturated fat lowers your risk of heart disease by around 40%, right? Can you imagine? That is as effective as most statin medications out there. Most cholesterol medications will lower your risk of heart disease by about 40%. Simply decreasing saturated fat and increasing unsaturated fat can do that. Unfortunately, only about 40% of adults over the age of 60 had minimal processed meat, meaning the majority, 61%, had more processed meat than 2 servings per week. That's a lot, way too much. So again, it's not so much what they don't, it's not just what they don't have, it is what they have also. Plant-based proteins are associated with, oops, sorry about that. Plant-based proteins are associated with favorable changes in blood pressure, waist circumference, weight, insulin sensitivity, risk of type 2 diabetes, reductions in fatty liver disease, right? So those are just some of the metabolic changes. Lower risk of diabetes with plant sources of protein versus increased risk of diabetes with animal protein. Processed meat did the worst. And potatoes and other, you know, starchy foods also were not good, right? So this is what happened in the early 80s is that doctors and the medical community said everybody should go on a low-fat diet. And unfortunately, what did we replace all that fat with? We replaced it with carbohydrate. And that was a bad, bad, bad move. What we should have replaced, what we should have done is not focused on low fat, but low saturated fat. And we should have, now in retrospect, we know that it's saturated fat that's the issue. And if you can replace saturated fat with unsaturated fat, which are the fats that come from plants, then you're going to be much healthier off. And so in observational studies that collectively followed over, you know, almost 250,000 lives, substituting 3% of your energy from animal protein with plant protein was associated with a lot of health benefits, lower cancer mortality, 50% lower risk of cancer mortality. And what are we talking about when we talk about 3%? It's not even, man, this is messed up again. I thought I fixed this. I apologize. This is supposed to be 1/3 of this can is uncovered. All right, so you just need like 1/3 of this can of black beans, this portion of tofu, or that much edamame. That's 3%. So if you could take 3% of your calories and subtract them from animal-based foods and replace it with this or this, or sorry, a third of that, just picture it, you would have a substantially lower risk of bad things happening to you. The fats, I know that some people that we invite onto these talks are very anti-oil and don't want you to have any fat. I'm not going to get into that argument today, but just know that certainly if you're eating any amount of saturated fat, and if you get that out and increase the unsaturated fat, you're going to get tremendous health benefits. Yeah. So this is what I said. Substituting good fats in for bad fats is a much more effective approach than reducing overall fat intake. Be careful who you call good fat. And then finally, fiber. So our ancestors consumed a wide variety of plant foods that gave them up to 100 grams of fiber a day, but most people in this country are at 15 grams. Now on this call, I imagine most of the people here are much higher than that, but fiber is a wonder, I'd call it a wonder drug. It's not a drug, but it is a miracle substance that does a lot of beneficial things, including reducing inflammation. Dietary fiber intake is associated with significantly lower risk of total death, 22% decreased risk of death, 40% lower risk of dying from cancer. And unfortunately, we are not, in this country at least, we are not where we need to be. And so certainly these kinds of items have tons of good, healthy fiber in them. Which is at least part of the reason why plant-based diets are so much healthier. And if you want to even get more, you can supplement with psyllium. The brand name that's sold is Metamucil, but you don't have to buy Metamucil. You can just buy psyllium at, lots of different stores these days. And this is, of course, why animal foods stink, because there's no fiber in them. Yeah, we're pretty bad in this country. Only 12% of adults over the age of 60 had greater than 4.5 cups per day of fruits and veggies. So there's clearly convergence of scientific evidence that an optimal diet is mostly plant-based. Not too surprising for this group on this call. Ornish diet has been rated number one for heart health for about a decade, a little bit more than a decade. But what's really interesting in my opinion is that some of these large societies are starting to get on the bus as well, get on the bandwagon, so to speak. It's really hard to move these large agencies. They get a lot of money. They are heavily lobbied by a lot of different industries. So it's really hard for them to come out against something. Certainly they are starting to move in that direction of promoting plant-based diets. The American Cancer Society, which has come under a lot of criticism for their recommendations over the years, in 2020 actually called for increasing plant-based foods and excluding red and processed meat to reduce cancer risk. So that was a big, big, big move when they did that. And of course, my society, the American College of Cardiology, as well as the American Heart Association, recommend plant-based and Mediterranean diets. And if you're going to eat animal protein, preferably fish, it says. That's the official recommendation. We can skip through that. Yeah. I mean, the focus is really for this conversation. I missed the very, very beginning when Terry typically asks how many people are plant-based on the call. If there are some that are not plant-based or are just starting to be curious about it, these are the things I would love for you to focus on. So with that, a healthy lifestyle should be rich in plant-based foods, beans, lentils, high-fiber foods. You should try to get moderate exercise. Try to focus on your sleep if you're not getting 7 to 8 hours. If you're having difficulty, if you have insomnia, there's some options for you. and you should try to minimize saturated fat, sodium, and refined carbs. I think that's it. Oh yeah, these are the rules I give to my patients, but we'll see how that. Okay. So with that, I know we went kind of quickly through some of that. I'm happy to answer some questions, and we can take me off of sharing, I think. I can try it. Oh, there it is.
Looks. Thank you so much, Dr. Liberman. That is important, very valuable information, well presented. And I love the cartoons.
I gotta try to inject some humor.
So right. I'm gonna check the chat box here and see if we've got some questions.
I can see them too. So let me just go through those. I'll start with the last one. I'm not saying that eating potatoes isn't healthy, but you just have to understand if that's your only vegetable, that's not a great choice, right? Potatoes do have fiber, especially if you're eating skin. They have a lot of minerals and elements, but you do have to understand it is a lot of carbohydrate too. In this country also, you have to understand that potatoes come in potato chips and in French fries. And so when they do surveys saying, you know, do you eat potatoes, that qualifies, French fries and all that stuff qualifies. So I'm not saying that potatoes are unhealthy, but at the same time, if you're eating a lot, if that's the majority of your diet, you do have to be careful of that carbohydrate load. Sharon asked, what about eating fish? I would say that certainly there's a lot of evidence that the healthiest diet is a plant-based or vegan diet, right? But the second healthiest diet in a lot of research is a pescatarian diet, where you're just eating fish plus vegetarian. Certainly fish has, a lot of omega-3s. Well, it depends on what you're eating, but potentially there's the potential for getting a lot of omega-3s, which we do think are healthy. That said, I do strongly believe that the healthiest diet is a plant-based diet with minimal animal products. So Vicky, 7 to 8 hours, 6 hours. No, I actually don't know that. I have to ask. I'm going to have to dig into the research about it. The question is if you sleep 6 hours at night and then take a 1 hour nap, does that equal 7 to 8 hours? It's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I imagine that it would be, if you can get into REM sleep during that nap, it would be fine. But I don't know that I've ever seen anything that looked at it that way. So that's a really good question. And I'm going to have to try to dig in and do some research about that.
Just along that line, I did come across something, and it wasn't, I don't know if there was a study in this regard or not, but just in the last couple of weeks, somebody talking about taking a nap, and if you just go into REM, if you just dream for a short period of time, that it does have some benefit, but that's, I don't know where that came from.
We typically dream when we're in REM sleep. So I have a lot of patients that we diagnose with sleep apnea. We get them treated, which means that they have a deficit of REM sleep, and we get them on treatment, whatever the treatment, there's a couple different treatments, but we get them on treatment and they finally get consistent REM sleep, and they come back and they say, holy cow, I'm dreaming again. I haven't had dreams in forever, which is interesting, which is nice. But yeah, so that would suggest that if you can have a dream during your nap, it suggests that you are getting into REM sleep, and that probably is sufficient then.
I've got a question on sleep as well. And I don't know if you know, doesn't matter when that sleep, that 7 hours or 8 hours comes. Some people say when the sun goes down, you're getting it, you're going to sleep late and sleeping well into the morning. Should you be doing it at the same time every day?
Yes. So in terms of sleep, that last question, so part of sleep hygiene, having a favorable, conducive environment for achieving quality sleep, you should try to keep your bedtime stable, right? Not all over the place. That is just good, what we call sleep hygiene. whether if you're getting your 7 hours or 7.5 hours, whether it starts at 6 p.m. or 10 p.m. or 11 p.m. or midnight, I'm not aware of any evidence, again, that splits those out. There is evidence that if your sleep cycle is switched, you know, because you're a night shift worker, then unfortunately night shift workers have worsened health outcomes. It is true. A lot of research support, you know, shows that. Now, part of that is, well, there's a number of reasons that go into that, but usually higher rates of insulin resistance and whatnot go into that. It's a good question. I will admit the sleep literature is not like my strong point. I read a lot of it, but I don't know all the ins and outs. I'm not a sleep physician. There is a whole other specialty for that. But I'm personally not familiar with any studies that break down bedtime or compare 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. kind of stuff.
Tom asked if we're supposed to have four or five servings of fruit a day, what amount equals a serving?
I think it depends on the fruit. You know, like one apple would be a serving, you know, a cup of grapes would probably be a serving. So I think it just varies depending on the fruit.
If anyone else has a question. Sorry. If anyone else has a question, if you'd like to put put the icon up with your hand up, we can call on you and we can just unmute you for that. We'll wait just a little bit here. And then in the meantime, let me just mention this. Our next meeting should be October the 12th, we're hoping to. If you'd like to receive notice of it or any of the upcoming other meetings and are not currently on our list, just Google us at pbnow.org. Once you're on our homepage, click the white Learn More button to register and you'll begin to receive notice of our upcoming events. I do see a question popped up here in the chat.
Yep. So it is true there are some medications that can cause poor sleep. Beta blockers, which are a common form of blood pressure medication, are associated with disruptions in sleep. So the question is how to get around that? Well, it depends on what the offending medication is and what it's needed for, and whether there are other options out there, right? So for example, with the example of the beta blocker, for example. So if I have a patient who's on a beta blocker and is telling me that they have poor sleep, I'll talk to them about switching to a different blood pressure medicine. But I'll also say, hey, you know, if you start exercising, if you watch your salt intake, if you start eating healthier, you might not even need that blood pressure medication anymore. And then we could just stop it completely. And that's going to help, obviously, a lot of things. It's going to help your sleep. It's going to help your, because the exercise and the diet that you're eating now are also going to be favorable for sleep. So there's just a lot of, I mean, they're all related. They're all connected. But the recommendation I give for that is to simply talk to the prescribing doctor and see if there are any other options. The comment was some depression meds can cause too much sleep. Sure. It depends on you can change the dosing if you're dosing in the morning or in the evening. There's all sorts of different things that can be done. And there's always options. There's almost every class of medicine has options within, you know, of similar medicines that may not cause that same side effect.
Yeah, I've got a question too in regard to, I know lifestyle medicine is a new, I don't know if you'd call it specialty, but a new board and thing. I imagine you're familiar with that, Dr. Liberman. And the what do you put up there as far as the Heart Association, is that right? We had those different items that we were covering, exercise, sleep, and that type of thing. It seems like there's kind of a convergence of some of these associations, as you mentioned, and lifestyle medicine.
The American College of Lifestyle Medicine, the ACLM, you can go to their website. It's pretty interesting. They have a lot of informative You know, they have a lot of good information on it. They also have, it's like a 8-point wheel of different things that contribute to better health. They also have, I think, stress management up there. And there's some, you know, they're every couple of years they tinker with it, but really, yeah, I mean, there, as Terry, you said it so succinctly, there is a convergence of a lot of these, health focused groups, health focused societies, of realizing what really goes into optimal health. And it's, you know, it's regular activity and exercise. It's not smoking. It's eating a healthy plant-based diet. It's getting good sleep. It's having community social support, you know, love in your life. It's, you know, there's a lot of arguments for part of it is getting out in nature. There's a big movement within the ACLM population of just actually being out in nature. There's a Japanese term. It's like Shinrin Goku or something like that. I'm doing a terrible job of it. But there's this concept of just being out in nature, not necessarily even doing something, just being out in nature is really beneficial. So there's all these different things that really contribute to healthy life.
And you touched on the stress management too, that how much anxiety there is out there right now.
Yep.
That's, I know that's a pillar of lifestyle medicine, teaching or having different techniques for reducing the stress. And of course, community is part of that. And nature, different ways to do this. Another question, this is from Eileen. What does Dr. Liberman think about intermittent fasting?
Yeah, this is good. This is fine. This is we're getting into just ask the doctor instead of talking about specific things about the slides. But that's fine. Intermittent fasting. So. There's some data to support that it's beneficial, certainly in animal models, focusing on like, say, rats and mice, the experimental mice and rats. If you starve them for periods a day, they live longer. We don't have good human being data on this, but there, it's certainly not going to be harmful. And I, to be honest, what I think it mostly does is prevents us from doing the kind of the brainless boredom eating at night that a lot of us do, right? We have dinner at 6 p.m. and by 7:30 or 8, we're sitting in front of the TV and we're not even hungry, but we're just munching on popcorn or pretzels or chips or something. And you're just doing it because you just have this motion that's going to your mouth and you're not even hungry. You just ate. So one of the real benefits I think of intermittent fasting is that it makes you conscious of that and removes that. And so it's going to be very effective at getting you to lose weight because you're obviously restricting a lot of the habits that get us into trouble, desserts and things like that. Whether it's actually hugely beneficial over just not snacking at night or something along those lines, I think the jury is a little bit out there. We don't have a lot of good human data on that. I will say that I don't dissuade people from doing it. And I just tell them, I don't know that we know for sure yet. If you're interested in learning a little bit more about it, anybody on here, you can check out my practice's website. It's wicardiology.com, WI Wisconsin, wicardiology.com. There's no punctuation, just wicardiology.com. And I have a link there. It's called News, but I've written a bunch of blog posts on all sorts of different things, including some things I covered today, or tonight, I should say. But I do have a blog post on intermittent fasting from about a month and a half ago or so. So feel free to go there and let me know what you think.
We've got a question, Monique. Monique, if you'd like to unmute.
Yes. I would like to know, I was diagnosed with insomnia and I also have high blood pressure. Does the high blood pressure affect the insomnia? Because you mentioned that it does, you know, the high blood pressure medication affects your sleep.
It can. Not all blood pressure medications affect sleep, but If I had to say something, I would say that it's flipped. It's more likely that the insomnia is causing the high blood pressure or contributing to it than the high blood pressure, just having high blood pressure causing insomnia. Because there's plenty of people out there that have high blood pressure that don't have any problems sleeping. But we know that lack of sleep, poor quality sleep will raise your blood pressure.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
Of course. And then there's a question, does taking melatonin interfere with the quality of sleep? And I think the answer to that is no. Melatonin is a naturally occurring hormone that naturally occurs in the brain. It is what we consider to be the sleep hormone. We know that as your brain and body are getting ready for sleep, as the night is going on, and again, you're staying away from technology, you're staying away from screens and whatnot, the levels of melatonin increase in your brain, making you sleepy, you fall asleep. And then in the morning, the levels of melatonin start to decline, and that's when we start to wake up. So I certainly don't know of any data that melatonin interferes with the quality of sleep. If anything, you can make an argument that it's likely to help the quality of sleep. You just can't expect to pop melatonin as you're laying on your bed, you know, as you're laying on your pillow and think that in 5 minutes it's going to kick in and put you to sleep. The best way to take melatonin is somewhere around, you know, 30, 45 minutes or 60 minutes before you plan on going to sleep. So again, if you're planning to go to sleep at say 10 p.m., you want to turn off technology at 9 p.m. You want to start doing something more contemplative. So again, no TVs, certainly no like action movies or loud noises, you know, some quiet background music, you know, classical jazz, something like that, if you want something like that. Otherwise, reading a book or a magazine or a newspaper, dim the lights a little bit, crossword puzzle, any of these kinds of things. But as you're turning all that off and getting into the next phase of your night, that's when you want to take the melatonin if you want to try it.
Excellent. Anybody else? Well, if we have no additional questions, thank you again, Dr. Liberman, for the excellent information.
One more thing. Can I do a shameless plug?
Sure. Go for it.
A week from Saturday, September 23rd, a week from this coming Saturday, the American Heart Walk, the American Heart and Stroke Walk, is in Veterans Park, downtown Milwaukee on the lake. We're going to have a booth there. There's going to be thousands of people out enjoying fresh air, getting some exercise, and it's for a real good cause. It's raising money. It's raising awareness of heart and stroke as well. For anybody that signs up, either through our website or through our Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or any of these different things that we do, we're going to donate $25 to the American Heart Association. But even if you don't want to sign up because you're worried about where your information goes, fine. Just show up. We got some nice fun swag for everybody who comes. We're going to have a booth there, hopefully we'll get a big crowd of people walking and raising awareness for a really important topic. So Saturday, September 23rd, the walk begins at 10 a.m. We'll be there starting at 9 a.m.
That sounds good. So you're starting late enough to give everybody enough sleep.
Exactly.
All right. Well, thanks everybody for coming tonight, and hope to see you next month. And thank you again, Dr. Liberman.